Now, I've been in this business for about a year. You know, when the boss asks you to give a talk, you cannot say no. And one of the things I like about these kind of endeavors is that you learn a lot yourself along the way. So the first thing I had to do when I figured out I had to give a talk was actually Google what survivorship has meant. And as it turns out, it's a very broad term. Survivorship means everything that happens after your diagnosis. And so the second thing I did was I emailed Brandon, the fellow that was organizing stuff on our end. I said, Brandon, exactly how long do I have to talk? He says, well, 25 minutes. I said, 25 minutes? So I had to kind of limit my talk to what I thought was most meaningful and most relevant to all the people in here. And presumably, most of you are melanoma survivors. So I figured what was most significant would be the early detection, not only of melanoma recurrences, but also the diagnoses of new melanomas and what we can do to minimize the risk. So my talk is going to be in four parts. First, I'll delve into the risk of recurrences and how they're distributed and when they're most likely to occur. And then I'll talk about what the current guidelines are in terms of what modalities we use for surveillance to detect recurrences and new primaries. And then I'll talk about two of the most powerful techniques that we all can use today to help manage or help detect the recurrences and new primaries. And then I'll talk about what we can do ourselves to manage the risk of new primaries. Okay, so Dr. Kashani and Dr. Leung, I believe I touched on this just a little bit. But basically, in general, the risk of a recurrence depends on the stage of the primary diagnosis. And generally, the higher the stage you're diagnosed with, the higher the risk of a recurrence. So for instance, if you have a melanoma in situ, a melanoma that's confined to the topmost layer of skin, the epidermis, surgery is generally considered curative, okay? But if you have a stage 2B, that which is up to 4 millimeters thick and invades the dermis, then you're a little bit higher risk of recurrence. And there's basically, four places that recurrences can happen. One is at the melanoma excision scar itself. Second is within the regional lymph nodes that communicate with that area of skin that pertains to the scar. Namely, that's the neck, the armpit or the axilla, or the groin, okay? The head and neck melanomas communicate with the lymph nodes in the neck. That's what we call what we mean by the regional basin. And also the melanomas that occur on the trunk above the level of the belly button can go to either armpit. Below the belly button and the lower extremities and around the groin area go to your groin lymph nodes. Those are the what we would call the draining basins. And then also, they can go to distant locations. If they get past those basins, they can go to distant places in the body, most notably the liver, the lungs, the brain, basically anywhere. Now, between the scar and the regional lymph nodes, sometimes the melanoma metastatic cells get caught in the lymphatic channels and actually bloom out there. That's what we call an in-transit metastasis, meaning it's on its way to the regional lymph nodes. And one thing I want to impress, that the risk of recurrence kind of diminishes with time. So time is on your side. And the risk of recurrence is highest in the first 2 to 3 years after diagnosis. And then it kind of tapers off. But it's important to impress upon you that the risk for recurrence never reaches zero. So that, what that means to you is there's a lifetime of surveillance in your future. Also, so there's a relationship between the initial stage of your diagnosis and the time to recurrence, and also the location where that most often recurs. So as I said earlier, if you're diagnosed with if you're diagnosed with a very early stage melanoma, surgery is generally considered curative. But there, again, the risk is still there. It's a very low risk, but the risk is still there. Stage 1 to 2, the recurrence happens less frequently, but over a longer interval of time. 80% of the recurrences happen within 5 years. Whereas if you're diagnosed with a melanoma that's already migrated to lymph nodes, the recurrences tend to happen in a shorter interval of time, within 3 years. And also the stage relates to actually where the recurrence is most likely to occur. So in stage 1 and 2, 70% are local, meaning at the scar, and regional, meaning at the lymph node basins. And 30% are in distant parts of the body, whereas a late stage diagnosis, or stage 3, only 50% are local and regional, and there's a 50% likelihood that the melanoma will occur in distant parts of the body. And all this, I'll just put in, since we have an international audience, I'm gonna make sure I kind of acknowledge the sources of this data. This information comes from a National Comprehensive Cancer Network, the NCCN, a very valuable resource for anyone with melanoma. So the NCCN puts together a task force that meets once a year, I believe, and our own Dr. Khushani actually headed the task force for many years. He's passed the baton now, but for many years he ran that. And they meet annually and review all the latest research and data, and really synthesize the algorithms that any dermatologist and oncologist worth their salt uses to for the treating of their melanoma patients. And not to sound too gloomy, but besides recurrence, melanoma survivors are at increased likelihood of developing new primary melanomas completely unrelated to their initial diagnosis. So they're at a 9-fold increased risk over the general population. And this risk is essentially remains the entire duration of your life, more than 20 years. Now that sounds like, it sounds a little stark, but if you think about it, we're looking in a very select group of people. Now melanoma survivors, we've already documented that they have the genetic predisposition, whatever that might be, lots of moles, red hair, fair complexion, environmental factors at play, lots of sun exposure in the past. But also, this risk might be related just to increased surveillance. And that's kind of evidenced by the fact that new primaries on melanoma survivors tend to be a lot thinner than their initial diagnosis. Okay, so what kind of modalities do we have at our fingertips to help detect recurrences and new primaries? One of them is, I had three on here, but you see I have a list of four here. I split the self-exam and the clinical exam up into two parts. The mainstay of melanoma surveillance to this day still remains the physical exam. And that can be divided up into the self-exam and the exam you have at your dermatologist office. Also, imaging studies, and that's more appropriate for advanced melanoma that's metastasized to the nodal basins and distant parts of the body. And also blood tests. And again, that only becomes relevant for more advanced melanoma cases, that which impact the liver function and hematologic responses. But I wanted to impress upon you that today, most recurrences and new primary melanomas are detected by self-exam or physical exams during the clinic. You know, the expensive imaging tests notwithstanding, this is basically how most recurrences and new primaries are discovered. So these are the new NCCN guidelines for follow-up. This is how we're going to go about detecting recurrences and new primaries. The recommendation is for anybody with a melanoma diagnosis is a full-body skin exam every 3 months. And usually the way we do that is alternate between our clinic and the patient's local dermatologist, such that you're seeing each provider every 6 months in kind of a staggered fashion. And the guidelines right now is to have that full body skin exam every 3 months for the first 2 to 3 years. And then if nothing happens, if there's no recurrence and no new primary, you can go to every 6 months, again, alternating between your local dermatologist and the melanoma clinic, every 6 months for the next 2 to 3 years after that. And if you're still no recurrence after 5 years, you're annually thereafter. Now, in between those clinic visits, it's important to perform the monthly self, skin, and lymph node exams. And I'll show you how to do that in just a few minutes. And in addition to the dermatology visits, surgical follow-up is appropriate as recommended. And there's no guidelines for that. It varies on an individual's basis. But people always ask me if they need to see Dr. Khashani and Dr. Leong. I say absolutely. Because some of the surgical complications can emerge months or even years after surgery, the most notable of which is lymphedema. And also, as a surgeon, Dr. Leong has a very intimate knowledge of lymphovascular anatomy. And so his lymph node exam is second to, is like getting a it's almost as if you're getting an ultrasound when he does his exam. So we highly encourage you to keep up with the surgical follow-up as recommended. Also in the guidelines is to offer genetic counseling to people with a history of more than three melanoma primaries, and also a history of other cancers that share a genetic predisposition with melanoma, namely pancreatic, breast, and ovarian cancer. And the reason for this is that if you find that you do have these genetic predispositions, we can refer you to a specialist for closer surveillance. We'll know what to look for in our clinical exams, and also for consultation with your children, as they might also carry the genetic mutation as well. All right, so that was for every stage. Now the follow-up for advanced stage 2B through stage 4 is a little bit different. You saw in the last recommendation, the general follow-ups, there was something missing. There was no interval imaging studies, and there was no routine labs being recommended. Those are more appropriate for these advanced stages. And the early stages, the imaging studies are only done on an as-needed basis when there's a clinical finding that's suspicious and meriting further follow-up. When someone's diagnosed with these advanced stage melanomas, usually what we'll do is get a baseline imaging study done, and that way it's a standard by which all subsequent studies are compared. So that really tells us, is the disease progressing, or hopefully is it regressing with the therapies that Dr. Miner and Dr. Kim have discussed today. Usually this will angle for the PET CT, and sometimes we get some pushback from the insurance companies, but we always angle for that first, and sometimes we have to settle for a CT. And depending on the location and the prognostic features of the melanoma, we might also angle for a brain MRI as well. After that, we'll usually follow up with serial imaging studies every 6 months, and we do that generally for every 6 months for the next 10 years. And the labs are given usually to monitor for side effects of the immunotherapy and the targeted therapy that Dr. Miner and Dr. Kim discussed. And also give us a little bit of prognostic information as far as the evolution of distant metastases as well. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about the self-skin exam. I hope everybody in here knows how to do this, but it's worth repeating. These slides come from the American Cancer Society website, which is just a treasure of patient information, and if it's cancer.org. Six steps here. The tools are quite simple. This is to be done on a monthly basis. Basically, you need a full-length or a wall mirror and a handheld mirror. And you start out facing the mirror, and you examine your head, face, ears, chest, arms, and fingers for any suspicious lesions. And we'll go into more detail in just a second about what constitutes a suspicious lesion. Next, you want to examine your under armpits and your flanks on both sides. And then you sit down, and you can look at the tops of your thighs, your shins, the tops of your feet, and between the toes. And then pick up your handheld mirror and look at the bottom of your feet and the back of your calves. And then you stand up and examine your buttocks and lower back. And then finish off by your using the handheld mirror in conjunction with the wall mirror and looking at your upper back and neck. Also at this time, you want to look at for melanoma on your scalp. And what is recommended is that we use a hair dryer to help kind of part the hair in real time there, and so you can look down in there on the cool setting and look for any suspicious lesions within the hairline. And again, we recommend this being done once a month. Okay, and we've seen this three times today, and it just kind of underscores how important this is. We all know about the A for asymmetry. One half doesn't look like the other. The border, irregular with lots of ragged, notched, or pigment, like infiltrating the surrounding skin. Color, variegated color, lots of shades of brown, black, white even, and pink. Anyway, it's not uniform throughout. Diameter is anything larger than the size of a pencil eraser, and E, most importantly, is for evolving. Anything changing in shape, size, or color. Also, neurologic symptoms like itching, tenderness. Is it becoming raised? Is it bleeding now? And also, for people with a history of melanoma, also it's important to look for new moles and new lumps, bumps in the nodal basins. And we'll get to the lymph node self-exam in just a minute. And here's kind of a gallery of primary melanomas that kind of fit all the ABCDE criteria. Now you can see this looks like this melanoma evolved from an existing mole. You see how nodular it is. You see it's larger than 6 millimeters. You see the color is variegated, and you see the edges are ragged. Here you see, there's a good example of regression. I think Dr. Miner alluded to this, that sometimes the immune system can spontaneously react to the melanoma. And you see this little white area in the middle there, and that's where the immune cells are attacking the melanoma. If this goes away, it doesn't mean it's cured. And a lot of times we don't like to see the primaries go away because people tend to forget about it and not follow up. And next thing you know, they have a goose egg-sized lymph node on the side of their neck. And this next picture is put in just to show you of how tricky that melanoma can be. You know, the textbook melanoma is always black and blue and and bleeding, but sometimes it can just present as a flesh-colored papule, just like that. That's an amelanotic melanoma. And this one's really tricky because it's flesh-colored and underneath the hair. So you have to be really vigilant in your skin exams. Next, we have some pictures of examples of recurrences, what they might look at. These pictures came from a website called regionalderm.com. It's got a huge gallery of skin lesions in it. Not a whole lot of guidance as far as medical treatment, though. But if you're interested to see what melanoma looks like, it's got a lot of pictures here. But this is a recurrence, a nodular recurrence at a scar here. You see this a red papule there right at the scar. That would be highly suspicious. Here's another recurrence at a scar. You see the area of pigmentation here. That would be very suspicious. There's nothing else like it around the periscar area here. And here's an example of the in-transit metastases I was talking about, where the metastatic cells became entrapped in the lymphatic vessels and essentially bloomed out onto the surface of the skin there. So any one of these kind of scenarios is definitely cause for concern and would merit immediate follow-up with us. So how do you really know if something is evolving? If, some people that come to our clinic are essentially like, there are so many moles or like leopards. It's like looking for something in a sapling in a forest of trees, okay? So there's one tool that's really evolved over the years to help manage that, and it's called mole mapping photography. And Dr. Kashani had a really nice picture of his setup, but this is the actual setup we have in the clinic, though I'm gonna keep it real here. So essentially, we take a series of overlapping photographs that when viewed in composite, you get representation of the whole body surface area. And so what we'll do is go through a series of four poses, and this camera is mounted on a rack, so we go up and down and have you turn 90 degrees and go up, down, and up, and you get the picture. You get the whole 360 degrees of representation. And then I'll provide you with a copy of the photographs on a USB drive and saved as a TIFF or JPEG format. And so it's no special proprietary image software that you need to view this. So it makes it portable. So you can take it home and open it up on your computer. And when you do your self-skin exams, if you have something there you can't remember if it's there or not, you can refer back to the picture and get a really accurate estimate as whether or not it's actually real or new or changing. Also, we keep the images stored on the computer here in the clinic. So as Dr. Kashani had a great example of how we've been able to diagnose some melanomas in the past based on this mole mapping photography. So it's very useful. We have there's anecdotal evidence in our clinic, and also it's been shown in the literature to be effective at identifying new and changing moles. Downside is I'd recommend this to everyone, but especially people with greater than 100 moles and a personal history or family history of melanoma. Downside is it's a little expensive, and unfortunately in the US, not a whole lot of insurances will reimburse you for. Generally the cost is $400 to $500, but at CPMC, it can all be yours for $370, so you get like a 10% discount there. And also, I think it qualifies as an FSA expenditure too. So that might, depending on what your tax bracket is, that might be another 15 to 20% off there too. The next one, I'll focus our attention on the recurrences and the lymph nodes. And I'll give you an overview of the lymph system. I don't think I can come close to what Dr. Leong has already done, but I'll try. The lymph system, the main function is to carry fluid away from your tissues and return it to venous circulation. And that's done, accomplished through lymphatic channels, like essentially veins, that lead to lymph nodes. And along the way, the fluid moves to the lymph nodes. And inside the lymph nodes, there's immune cells. And they're constantly sampling that lymph fluid for pathogens, bacteria, and viruses. And if it encounters one, those lymph nodes, the cells will proliferate. And that's what causes the lymph nodes to enlarge and become tender when you're suffering from an infection. Okay? And we talked about the nodal basins. And usually on a clinical exam, the lymph nodes cannot be felt. You say, well, I can't feel anything at all, so that's a good thing. You shouldn't be able to feel anything. An occasional exception is sometimes the lymph nodes in your groin can be felt. They should be very small, and that's what we call shoddy lymph nodes. But usually, we can't feel anything. Okay, and this is a lymph node exam that should be done in conjunction with your self-skin exam every month. And it's very easy, and you get practice that it will take you 30 seconds to do. And you start to, but just take your index finger and middle finger and just go small circles from your ears to the back of your ears, and then along your jawline, and then down your neck. And sometimes it helps to keep the muscles loose, so you want to kind of lean your head to the side you're trying to examine, just so you can get your fingers down in there underneath the muscle. And in the very base of the neck, you want to kind of hunch your shoulders and move them forward so you can get down in there above the collarbone there. Next, you want to check the axillary or the armpit basins. And what you want to do is take your three middle fingers and put them up under your arm. Just keep your arm loose, put it up under your arm, and then let that arm kind of hang loose. Okay? And you want to put firm pressure on your chest wall, start in the middle, then come to the front, and then to the back, okay? And then feel along the inside of your arm, okay? And so you were looking for any kind of pea-size nodule in there, okay? And I have to give credit to the British Association of Dermatologists for providing, they have a really nice brochure that's available on the internet. And lastly, the groin. The lymph nodes are arranged in a horizontal group and a vertical group. So right along the crease here is where the inguinal ligament is. So you want to feel just along the crease in your groin, just gentle pressure, and then down on the inside upper part of your thigh. And the name of this slide is don't freak out if you feel a lymph node, especially if it's tender. As we just talked about the lymph node's function in the immunological response to pathogens, and the tender lymph node and large lymph nodes could likely due to infection. Generally, it takes about a week or two for that to resolve, so call us if you feel a lymph node and it persists for more than 2 weeks. But don't get too excited because it could very well go away. So this is a list of, next I want to talk about melanoma risk management, particularly recurrence, particularly new primaries. And this is a comprehensive list of every known modifiable risk factor that we know with 100% certainty that affects your risk for melanoma. And that's only one thing, it's UV radiation. So the rest of the talk is going to be focused on, you know, what can we do to manage our UV radiation exposure. And I always like the simple approaches to things. And the first thing is to seek shade. Just stay out of the sun. And what I usually tell the patients is to avoid sun exposure between 10 and 4 p.m. And if you like to get a little bit more scientific about it, you know the sun rays are the strongest. This is a shadow test. If your shadow is shorter than you are, then the sun is at its peak and you should avoid being out in it. And if you want to get even more scientific, there's a UV index. And UV index is available on, I know it's the Weather Channel app that you can put on your iPhone. It has a forecast and UV index every day. And this figure came from the EPA.gov, I guess before the gag order was put in there. But usually has four levels, like a low, intermediate, high, very high, and extreme. And even at the moderate levels, the recommendation is to take these sun protective measures that we're going to talk about. The second thing you can do besides avoiding the sun is protect your skin with clothing. So dark clothing tends to give a better protection than light clothing. You want a really tight weave in the fabric so that no sunlight gets through. And some of the dry clothes are better than wet clothes. We all know what happens when a white T-shirt gets wet. You can see right through it. And there's also specialized UV protective clothing available. Now, that doesn't mean you have to go out and buy this stuff, but it tends to be made out of synthetic stuff that's lightweight and more comfortable to wear in the sun. And it's really fashionable right now. It doesn't look like specialized clothing. As a matter of fact, my 10-year-old daughter saw this slide last night. She said, "That looks like real clothes, Daddy." I said, "Yeah, it's like it is." And I'm not endorsing this. This is one vendor I found online, Coolabar, and I just want to give them credit for the pictures here. But there are a lot more providers out there for you. And of course, we want to talk about sunscreen. Dr. Kashani talked about the clinical trial run in Australia at length, and reduce your risk of melanoma by 50 and even up to 70%. I think if all those medications that Dr. Miner and Dr. Kim were talking about even approached that efficacy, they would be very proud of themselves. So sometimes, the simple solutions are effective. So there's two classes, physical and chemical sunscreens, and the physical consists of titanium dioxide and zinc dioxide. And they form an impenetrable barrier, a physical barrier on your skin. And these have been around for a while. The white stripes on the noses of the surfers, the old school type of zinc oxide. The manufacturing has come a long way where all that is micronized now such that it doesn't leave that cakey layer on your skin. And there's two types of UV, UVA and UVB. I won't get into the differences, but the fact of the matter is that the differences are academic. Both can cause skin cancer, so we need to avoid them both. And we recommend sunscreens with physical barriers because it's the only class that offers complete blocking of UVA and UVB. If you don't like the feel of the physical sunscreens, there are some chemical sunscreens that approximate or come close to it. One is the oxybenzone, and that's the active ingredient found in a lot of the Neutrogena sunscreens you can find at Target, but it's only a partial UVA blocker. And there's a great discussion of this on the AIM at Melanoma website. It's where I got this information. So this is sometimes the sunscreen labels can be confusing. You want to select one that's broad spectrum, and that means it blocks both UVA and UVB. You want to select a SPF of at least 30. Now, sometimes I believe there's diminishing returns on the SPF, and it might be just because people are misinformed about it. But I just anecdotally, I went out and bought, before I started working with melanoma, I went and bought SPF 100, right? And thinking, you know, I'll only have to apply it every 6 hours versus every 2 hours. And as you can imagine, I got fried that day. So even if it's SPF 100, you still need to apply it every 2 hours. Look for water and sweat resistant. That, if it's on the label, that means it can remain effective for 40 minutes of swimming and 80 minutes of sweating. The Skin Cancer Foundation seal, there's plenty of sunscreen, good sunscreens out there without it, but this gives you a little bit of assurance that the clinical data has been reviewed by an independent panel with the Skin Cancer Foundation, and they approve of that. And also check for the active ingredients. And again, we recommend the physical barriers over the chemical ones. So slop on the sunscreen. So the recommendation is about an ounce of sunscreen of at least SPF 30 should be used to cover the body. Not many people know what an ounce is, but everybody knows what a shot glass is. So that's about how much sunscreen. If you think about it, that's a big glob of sunscreen. Most of us don't put enough on. But just kind of anchor that in your mind next time you're out in the sun. And again, every 2 hours, regardless of what SPF you need. Also, wear a hat at least 2 to 3 inches all around. And also, we recommend sunglasses. As you know, you can get melanoma in your eyes as well. And I want to caution you just to check the label. It will indicate if it's UV protective, it will say so on the label. UV absorption up to 400 nanometers or meets ANSI UV requirements, blocks 99%. Otherwise, you can make an assumption that it's only blocking about 70%. And the last word on managing UV exposure is avoid tanning beds and sun lamps. Spray tans are okay. In fact, they have a presidential seal of approval on there. But I want to caution you that the spray tans don't provide any UV protection. So it's still important to wear sunscreen, even if you have a... And I just want to put a last thing. I just want to put in a spot in for... psychosocial support. There's been some preliminary data that suggests that psychosocial support may improve risk of recurrence and overall survival. The data is preliminary. There's been very small clinical trials being done, but it's very exciting. And it's not hard to rationalize how that might help. A melanoma diagnosis, as you know, is a very stressful situation. And that affects your level of hormones, particularly cortisol, that can be suppress your immunity. And we all know how important, based on Dr. Miner's talk, is how important the immune system is to controlling melanoma. So if that's suppressed, you can imagine that you could be at higher risk for recurrence. So I didn't know we were having an international audience today, but I did put up the CPMC at near our melanoma clinic is putting on a monthly support meeting that's mediated by a social worker and two oncology nurses, not me, but I'd like to be involved. It meets on the first Tuesday of the month. And I didn't put the phone number up here for registration, but I have it in my pocket. So if you're interested, I'll be more than happy to provide you with that. Now, for everybody out there watching online, there's a great resource on the AIM at Melanoma website that you can just scroll through the menu with all the states, and they'll give you the names, the location, and contacts of all the melanoma support groups. This is not melanoma specific, but if they can get more enrollment, they will consider adding a melanoma specific support group. This is just general cancer. Okay, and then the conclusions, I think they're pretty clear. Risk of recurrence remains high, most high in the first 5 years, but it never reaches zero. So a lifetime of surveillance is what we really need. And those are regular self-skin exams and dermatological exams. Okay, and also managing UV exposure. It's the only modifiable risk factor that we know of. And also want to put another plug in for the psychosocial support. resources are great. The American Cancer Society website is a treasure. As I said, lots of slides came from their website. The National Comprehensive Cancer Network. Anybody with a diagnosis of melanoma, I'm recommending that they get this book. It's pretty comprehensive. It tells you, it goes through all the prognostic features of melanoma. It tells you how to interpret a pathology report. It goes through step by step in layman's terms about all the treatment options available to you. It also goes through all the surgical standards of care. Very, very good. You have to go to the NCCN.org, and you have to register with your email address and a password, but that's free of charge, downloadable as a PDF. It's about 120 pages. Also, Aim at Melanoma. It's good for all the sunscreen discussion and all the support groups, and also the Skin Cancer Foundation is another good resource. And that's it. Thank you so much. Okay.